provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The Philippine Health Department tags 5 areas in Metro Manila with moderate risk for COVID-19. This comes as health authorities expand the coverage of booster shots to 12 to 17-year-olds in the general population. A decision by the U.S. Supreme Court to strike down the constitutional right to abortion sparks a storm of criticism and widespread condemnation. And a prosecutor of the International Criminal Court wants another crack at the Duterte administration's bloody drug war, saying the Philippine government did not do enough in its drug war probe. Good afternoon, I'm Stanley Palisade. You're watching Top Story. We begin with developments in the Philippine capital's COVID-19 situation. Philippine health authorities say 5 areas in Metro Manila are now under moderate risk for COVID-19. These are Pasig, San Juan, Quezon City, Marikina, and Pateros. While Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergere says there is no need to be alarmed, she urges the public to stay vigilant.
Kasama po sa metrics natin ng health systems capacity. This is the hospital utilization. At pag tinignan ho natin, even though moderate risk case classification itong 5 areas, isa lang po sa kanila ang merong medyo pagtaas ng pag-admit sa ospital and the rest are less than 50%. Sa ngayon, base po sa ating datos, hindi pa po natin nakikita that we will be escalating, no, ang National Capital Region to a higher alert level kasi katulad nga ng sabi ko, mas binibigyan po natin ng weight ito pong hospital admissions natin because we know that the COVID-19 will really cause infections.
And as the cases rise, the Philippine Health Department is now allowing the expanded coverage of the COVID-19 booster shots to include kids aged 12 to 17 years old in the general population. For this update, we have on the line ABS-CBN correspondent Michael De Liso joining us. Michael, good afternoon. What do you have so far for us?
Yes, good afternoon, Stanley. Health authorities have expanded the administration of COVID-19 booster shots to everyone aged 12 to 17. A week after this was rolled out to only cover those with health risk, Department of Health spokesperson Undersecretary Maria Rosario Berhere said the agency now expects the uptake of booster doses in its age bracket will increase in the following weeks. She also gave assurances there is enough supply of Pfizer vaccines, which has the only emergency use authorization as a third dose for the said age group. The booster shot for 12 to 17 years old started on Monday, but only for those immunocompromised. Meanwhile, the health department is also in discussion with the experts for the rollout of second booster shot for all immunocompromised frontliners, not just healthcare workers. They are also studying the administration of fourth dose for the 50 to 59 age bracket.
Actually, we started our discussions with our experts last week pa po kung saan yung iba't ibang sektor na pwede natin maisama ay pinag-aaralan na po. No? Tinitignan na natin ang evidences.
The DOH is expected to present the results of the discussion to the Interagency Task Force for the Management of Emerging Infectious Diseases on Monday. If approved, the DOH will then work with the Food and Drug Administration and Health Technology Assessment Council to iron out the specific requirements. Back to you, Stanley.
Thanks a lot for the update, Michael De Liso. Moving on, a COVID-19 vaccine that's effective against the Omicron variant could be out later this year. European pharmaceutical giants Sanofi and GlaxoSmithKline say their vaccine showed a 72% efficacy against symptomatic infections in the late-stage trials. And when used in those who have already had COVID, the protection was 83 or 93%. This could be the world's first vaccine that specifically fights the highly transmissible Omicron variant, which is causing upticks across the globe. Thailand is scaling back its COVID-19 curbs following a decline in new infections and fatalities in recent weeks. Now people are free to choose whether they want to wear a face mask outdoors or in public places. But while face mask use is now voluntary, the Ministry of Public Health is still encouraging the public there to mask up in certain situations. These include crowded venues and areas with poor air circulation or when physical distancing is not possible. Thailand is now transitioning to a post-pandemic phase as it further relaxes restrictions. Now it has reopened pubs and bars and scrapped the Thailand pass requirement for international arrivals, effective July 1st. Singapore eases movement curbs for migrant workers after 2 years. Migrant workers who no longer need special passes to leave their dormitories, which is a move hailed by a local group, but it points out some restrictions, which the group described as discriminatory, remain. That includes still requiring workers to apply for permission to visit four popular locations on Sundays and public holidays.
There's no more restrictions in terms of the numbers of people at specific locations. Okay, although there may be event-based restrictions, but for the rest of us, we don't have movement restrictions anymore. We don't even have movement tracing. So it's difficult to see why those restrictions still apply to migrant workers simply based on the basis of their work pass type and their residence type.
Around 300,000 migrant workers, mostly from Southeast Asia, live in dormitories in Singapore. The vast complexes were hit by COVID-19 and locked down at the start of the pandemic. A historic day in America as the U.S. Supreme Court strikes down the constitutional right to abortion. The conservative-denominated or dominated court overturned the landmark 1973 Roe v. Wade decision. This means individual states can now permit or restrict abortion. Roughly half of the 50 U.S. states are now expected to outright ban and criminalize abortions. For U.S. President Joe Biden, the decision is a tragic error by the Supreme Court.
It was three justices named by one president, Donald Trump, who are the core of today's decision to upend the scales of justice and eliminate a fundamental right for women in this country. Make no mistake, this decision is a culmination of a deliberate effort over decades to upset the balance of our law.
Biden now calling on Congress to act. The White House Republicans lauded the ruling. Democratic House Speaker Nancy Pelosi vowed to ferociously fight the decision.
With this decision, the conservative majority of the Supreme Court shows how extreme it is, how far removed they are from the majority of this country. They made the United States an outlier among developed nations in the world. But this decision must not be the final word. My administration will use all of its appropriate lawful powers, but Congress must act. And with your vote, you can act.
The U.S. draws international condemnation after its Supreme Court struck down the constitutional right to abortion. The Office of UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres says restricting access to abortion does not prevent people from doing it. It only makes it more deadly. The head of the World Health Organization also disappointed with the decision, saying he had expected America to protect women's rights. For the Human Rights Watch, access to abortion is not only a public health imperative, but a basic human right. The Vatican, on the other hand, praised the decision, saying it challenges the world to reflect on life issues. It also called for social changes to help women keep their children. More fallout from the decision to overturn the landmark Roe v. Wade ruling. Hundreds took to the streets to show their outrage. Don Tagala has details.
For nearly 50 years, it was the law of the land. Until on Friday, when the U.S. Supreme Court overruled Roe v. Wade, effectively taking away 50 years of federal abortion rights of women. The landmark 6-3 ruling is expected to ban or restrict safe abortion procedures for over 40 million women across at least 26 states. These include Kentucky, Louisiana, and South Dakota, where a so-called trigger law kicked in automatically upon a Roe v. Wade reversal, banning the procedure immediately in almost all circumstances. Shame, shame, shame. Hundreds of pro-choice advocates took to the streets of Washington, D.C. to show their outrage over SCOTUS's decision.
My body, my choice! My body, my choice!
I was numb. I never thought it would come to this. I feel like this just signed the deaths of millions of folks who really need this, and this is just such a shame. And I'm pissed. I just have no words.
This protester says she fought for her own reproductive rights in 1973. Today, she is fighting for her daughters.
Never thought I'd have to be thinking about this again. And so I have a daughter who's rabid about this and said, Mom, if you're in D.C. today, you got to go. So we flew in this morning, got up at 4:30, got on the plane and got here and came straight here.
Several states that will ban or criminalize abortion is home to growing Asian American communities, including Filipino Americans. These Filipinas attending this APIA vote gathering are outraged by SCOTUS's ruling to have these federal protections taken away from women.
I'm so disheartened that a group of mostly male judges overturned something that impacts women. And now that right has been taken away, I just feel that now there's going to be unsafe practices that we should all be concerned. Again, I don't feel men shouldn't, or anyone should be deciding what we can and can't do with our bodies.
Let's not criminalize the person who has to decide. Para anong gagawin nila sa sarili nilang katawan? Kailangan nila ng decision. kailangan nila ng karapatan.
As the Supreme Court flexes its muscles, some experts fear the court decision will be a precedent that could jeopardize other rulings, including those protecting interracial and same-sex marriages. Don Tagala, ABS-CBN News, Washington, D.C.
The man caught on video attacking a Filipino-American family in North Hollywood refuses to appear in court to enter his plea. This report from our North America Bureau correspondent, Steve Angeles.
He may be in police custody, but the man caught on video attacking a Filipino family in a fast food parking lot last month still refuses to enter his plea. After not appearing in court on Thursday, 31-year-old Nicholas Weber was scheduled to appear for his arraignment on Friday morning. However, the court told the Roque family and their supporters that he refused to leave his cell. This has now led to the court ordering an extraction to forcibly remove him from his cell and bring him to court on Monday morning. Weber is facing one felony battery count and one misdemeanor battery count with hate crime enhancements. On May 13th, Weber was filmed spewing racially charged threats at the Roque family after his Jeep allegedly bumped their car. He then physically attacked them. Weber, who authorities describe as unemployed and has a lengthy criminal record, was eventually detained on an unrelated matter in Orange County on June 16. During a community event, District Attorney George Gascon told the Neighborhood Safety Companions that the case was being filed and were speaking to the Roques. However, the Roque family criticized the district attorney's handling of the case and a lack of transparency, especially when it came to the arrest of Weber, where the family was not informed that he had been detained in another jurisdiction for several days before being sent to Los Angeles. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News, Los Angeles.
We have the latest on the hoop career of former UP Fighting Maroon Richie Rivero. Now the high-flying shooting guard is taking his talents to Taiwan. Rivero's agency has confirmed that he has signed with the Tau U1 Pilots in the P League Plus, making him the first Filipino to play as an import in the league. Rivero helped UP end its 36-year title drought in the UAAP men's basketball competition last season. He also bagged the championships with the De La Salle University in 2016 during his rookie year. We'll take a short break. Stay with Top Story.
Sama-sama po tayong pabangon muli.
Ferdinand Romualdez Marcos Jr., the duly elected President of the Republic of the Philippines.
Catch ANC special coverage of President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s inauguration on June 30, starting at 9 in the morning.
Welcome back to Top Story. Incoming Migrant Worker Secretary Susan Toots Ople says she will focus on addressing concerns often raised by overseas Filipino workers. Among them are the workers' numerous requirements and the hike in PhilHealth premium payments, which OFWs say is redundant since they are already provided with insurance by their host countries. Another initiative Ople would like to implement is a command center for repatriation. The incoming secretary also says she is now coordinating with the Department of Information and Communication to help the agency automate their systems. This is expected to help streamline processes and provide efficient assistance to OFWs.
Ma-expand din yung ating polo, hindi na siya polo. Migrant Workers Office na siya. Gagawa kami ng One Repatriation Command Center. So lahat ng request ng repatriation, doon na mapupunta. And yung command center na yon ang makikipag-usap sa mga pamilya.
A survey conducted by a U.S.-based think tank shows Filipinos are the most stressed workers in Southeast Asia. Sen Hernandez with a full story.
Yan works in a highly stressful environment as a call center agent. And since she lives outside Metro Manila, she's also physically drained from daily four-hour commutes to and from work. Despite all her hard work, her family is still struggling to make ends meet.
Mahirap po kasi ano, may mga trabaho din naman po yung ano ko, yung mga magulang ko, pero hindi po nagkakasya yung budget sa araw-araw. Masyado pong mahal yung mga bilihin, tsaka yung gas pati. Kaya po nagko-commute na lang din po ako. Kaya nga po, gusto ko sana ano na lang, sa bahay na lang magtrabaho eh. Pero hindi po kasi pwede kasi sa company po namin bawal po mag-work from.
According to a survey by Gallup Inc., a U.S.-based management consulting firm, 44% of workers globally are suffering from stress, an all-time high. This is despite the world slowly being able to manage the pandemic. Europe and Southeast Asia appear to be the hardest hit by COVID-19 waves, with only 11% of their workers saying they are thriving. In Southeast Asia, the Philippines had the most stressed workers. According to the Federation of Free Workers, Filipino workers have been stressed for decades due to issues in working conditions made worse by the pandemic and the rising prices of commodities.
Yung dagdag na stress na contractual ka, napakalaking stress factor din yung trabaho ka ng trabaho, pero alam mo, pag uwi mo, kulang pa rin yung may uwi mong pantustos sa pamilya mo. Lahat na yata ng wage boards ay nakapaglabas na ng kanilang respective wage orders. Mukhang kulang pa rin.
The group appeals for long-standing labor issues to be addressed and for the scrapping of the excise tax on fuel to help bring down fuel prices. But Senator Sherwin Gatchalian believes austerity measures should first be considered.
Scrapping it is too drastic. No, dahil malaki ang kita ng gobyerno dyan, almost 300 billion a year. Maghanap tayo ng paraan para mapababa pa yung expenses ng gobyerno. Mag-zoom muna. No, dahil traveling expense, napakalaki rin yan eh.
The senator is also encouraging the private sector to revive work-from-home arrangements. FFW agrees since this has been instituted under the Telecommuting Act. But work-from-home arrangements cannot apply to industries like manufacturing, where workers need to be physically present to perform their jobs. Zen Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
Two towns in South Cotabato are placed under red status due to rising cases of African swine fever. Lady Vicencio has details.
Pork prices in Kamuning Market decreased by 5 pesos Friday with the influx of supply coming from Bulacan. Retailers say the demand is not that high, especially with the high cost of pork in recent months.
Tingin ko walang pera ang tao. Pagka naglalakihan na yung baboy, ibig sabihin marami ng supply yan. Kasi mahina nga ang bentahan, kaya ang nangyayari, kokonti ang nakakatay.
Pork Producers Federation of the Philippines says African swine fever continues to spread across Luzon and some parts of Visayas and Mindanao. But retailers say its effect is not yet felt in Metro Manila. In South Cotabato, towns of Banga and Soralia are under red status with rising cases of ASF.
Ay, nagkakal na rin tayo at sinisiguro rin natin na lahat ng mga kinakal natin ng mga baboy ay nababayaran rin.
This piggery in Banga is now empty after 4,000 swines were culled to prevent the spread of the virus.
Kung may makita kami ano, mga positive na mga karne, kinakumpiskate talaga namin.
In General Santos City, all types of vehicles should submit to the animal quarantine checkpoint. The city veterinary office warns that around 8.4 billion pesos could be lost in the swine industry if the disease continues to spread. Meanwhile, sugar retail prices increased anew by 10 pesos per kilo. Traders implemented a hike following the recent hike in petrol prices. Agriculture Secretary William Dar defends the Sugar Regulatory Administration's decision to import sugar due to a supply shortage.
You need to continue to boost productivity of sugar. The industry needs sugar. They were balancing their actions. Matagal na yun sinasabi namin may pagkukulang.
The SRA insists the importation was not a midnight deal. Administrator Hermenegildo Serafica explains they projected the shortage way back in February after sugar-producing areas were hit by Typhoon Odette and other weather disturbances. He also foresees a supply shortage in the coming months, with delays in importation because of the temporary restraining orders secured by sugar producers. United Sugar Producers Federation stands by its statement that there is enough sugar supply in the country.
Anong tawag po na may shortage tayo.
Opo.
For this
Opo.
Month and next month po, ang daming-daming asukal natin sa bansa.
With a few days left before a new administration takes over, the Trade and Industry Department has decided to let the new administration decide on the request of manufacturers to hike prices.
Proseso ng price adjustment, hindi yan biglaan na iaakyat agad. Tinitingnan yung actual costing. Dine-verify po yon, tapos ay nagkakaroon ng diskusyon sa with manufacturers.
Lopez adds the decision for price hikes should not be hurried as they need to strike a balance between the interests of manufacturers and consumers. Lady Vicencio, ABS-CBN News.
International Criminal Court Prosecutor Karim Khan wants to resume his investigation into the Duterte administration's bloody drug war. Khan says he has already filed a request before the ICC pre-trial chamber. That's as he accused the Philippine government of not demonstrating that it has investigated or is investigating the alleged crimes committed in the drug war. That government review was the basis for the ICC to accept the Philippine government's request to suspend the probe in November 2021. Khan adds, the information provided by the Philippine government only refers to a small portion of the killings in the drug war and has not led to any criminal prosecution. The ICC pre-trial chamber in September last year authorized Khan to investigate a drug war from July 1, 2016, when President Rodrigo Duterte came into office, until March 16, 2019, when the Philippines withdrew from the ICC. The probe also covered Duterte's time as mayor and vice mayor of Davao City. Various groups laud the International Criminal Court's request to resume its investigation on the drug war killings in the Philippines. The Human Rights Watch calls it a booster shot for accountability, as it asserts the Philippine government has not been serious in bringing justice to the families of the drug war victims. Now, local rights group Karapatan echoing that statement. Meanwhile, Anak Pawis Party List dares President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. to allow the investigation to resume, saying Marcos has no business being the president if he will coddle his predecessor. The National Union of People's Lawyers also urging the incoming administration to allow the investigation, which National Security Advisor designate Clarita Carlos already said she is in favor of. Malacanang says it feels exasperated with the statements of Prosecutor Khan. Acting Palace spokesman Martin Andanar maintains the drug war has been successful in lowering the crime rate related to drugs. In other news, nostalgic music to entertain Philippine President-elect Marcos Jr. and his guests on the day of his inauguration. Mario Dumawal with the details.
Apart from the glitz and glamour, music will play an essential part at the inaugural of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. Veteran musician Mel Villena and his AMP band has been tapped to play two sets of one-hour song numbers at the dinner reception in Malacañang on June 30. Performing with Villena are Gail Blanco Viduya, Robert Senya, Isay Alvarez, Ima Castro, and Chris Villonco in a mix of American and Western-inspired Pinoy jazz as well as OPM dance hits and a sprinkling of BTS K-pop music. Villena regards it as an honor to continue to perform before five Filipino presidents since the time of Fidel Ramos. He also cited Marcos' support of Filipino musicians and big band shows through the years. Who knows, he quipped, Marcos might even jam with them with his skill in playing saxophone. Acclaimed pianist Cecil Licad and the Philippines Philharmonic Orchestra, or PPO, will also headline the dinner reception show. According to National Commission for Culture and the Arts head Nick Lizazo, Villena also told ABS-CBN News he has prepared a special number to be rendered by Tony Gonzaga at the Palace Dinner. Gonzaga has also been asked to sing the national anthem at Marcos' inauguration at the National Museum. It's a distinct role taken on by Charisse Pempenco in 2010 and Nora Honor in 2004. Of her participation in the momentous event, Bilyongco told ABS-CBN News that she only wishes the best and the common good of our country. Meanwhile, Senya and Alvarez expressed happiness over their participation at the palace dinner reception. Despite the pomp and glitz, organizers still want to keep the inaugural event austere and dignified in keeping with the times. A free concert for the public on June 30 in another venue is still being worked out. Mario Dumawal, ABS-CBN News.
Catch ANC's special coverage of the inauguration of President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. on June 30th. It will begin at 9 in the morning until 4:30 in the afternoon. We will be talking to political analysts and incoming government officials. These include historian Manolo Quezon and incoming National Economic and Development Authority Chief Arsenio Balisacan. And before we go, Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte gets a sweet tribute days before he steps down from office. This patisserie chef from Pampanga Province showed her appreciation with a bust-sculptured cake featuring the president. Fatima Garcia shares it took her 2 days to make the 1-foot 3D figure cake of Duterte. She wants to thank the outgoing leader for his service and for helping the country throughout the COVID-19 pandemic. Garcia also believes Duterte will continue to serve even as he returns to private life. And those were the top stories today. I'm Stanley Palisade. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.